Every day in the gym, one day no gym, cheat meal.
Cheat meal. Every day.
Every day, no.
Not every day.
Not every day. One day a week.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Today, cheat meal.
Come on, DJ, cheat meal. What are you gonna have?
Okay. One churro of Nutella.
Nutella?
Oh, okay. Yeah, true.
I'm excited for Nutella. Yeah. Thank you so much. Gracias.
It's not every day you get to sit down and have lunch and a chat with an artist like Rosalía, you know, uniquely private and in her creative process until she's ready, and she is. This new album, Motomami, will no doubt push music and culture a couple of degrees off axis into new territory once again. So we sat down, ate some food in Santa Monica, which was not her first choice.
We were supposed to be in Barcelona.
Yes, I know. Mm. I wanted you to try los churros. That we do there.
I know, and I would have loved to have, and it was a great opportunity, but we just
listen, I'm happy that we're here because it's the first time I'm gonna try churros. That here is different, right? They put cinnamon.
Yeah.
They put other things, so it's the first time I'm gonna try.
Yeah.
You know what we do in Barcelona? Uh-huh. When you go party, mm-hmm. you go to a club, mm-hmm. at 6 a.m. or something, maybe you're leaving the club, churros. And then you eat churros.
That's the greatest after-club snack of all time. You know, in Britain, in London where I lived, they get these things called kebabs.
Kebabs?
Kebabs. Yeah, but not like a Camden Town kebab. This thing is like... It is like that big.
Yes.
And it's basically there to soak up all the alcohol that you've been drinking during the
night. Barcelona, they do kebabs too, and they're like this.
Yeah,
like,
far more like sophisticated.
I would have loved to come to Barcelona and had a kebab and a churros, but we're here in Los Angeles because the travel thing is, we're getting closer and closer. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate you being here. You have every reason to be here. It's about to happen. This album's about to come out. It's so crazy. We have been very patient, but it's so worth it.
This you were always asking me.
I know, I'm annoying. I'm the worst fan.
You were always asking me, like, when is it going to be done?
I know.
When is the album coming
and
out?
And I'm not apologizing for any of it.
You were asking me, and I was like, oh, he's going to be happy that finally my answer is going to be different.
It's done.
Yeah.
No, when I pressed play on it, it was just, I was excited, and it's so much anticipation and start to finish. I mean, I called people. When I hear music that I truly love, and I'm sure everyone does this, you call people. It's not even done. You just call people. You go, oh my God, this is it. And I was just calling people. When I get to different songs, I just call people. Because,
really?
Yeah, because it's so exciting and eventful and so many amazing creative ideas. But, you know, the songs are so great. And all the effort you put in is... And we're going to talk about all that. But I want to talk a bit about Los Angeles because we're here.
Yes.
And even though it's not Barcelona where your life began, in many respects, you know, a big part of your story began here. I mean, you mm-hmm. called your first album proper, that beautiful collection of songs from the songbook, Los Angeles.
Right.
And I just wanted to, because we're going to speed up to the present moment very quickly, but I wanted to ask you, being back here, how you feel about this city and how it treated you back then. Did it treat you kind? Was it tough? Did it teach you tough life lessons? Was it warm? What was it like then?
I think there's both. I find both that kindness and that tough energy too, combine in LA. I can feel both. And I think I felt it when I first came. It was maybe three years ago. I don't even remember, like I think 4 years ago, to shoot the Plata, that video for the album Los Angeles. Mm. Mm. And then to create Motomami, I spent a lot of time here in LA too, because the people I was collaborating with, they were here.
Yeah.
So, it really made sense that it's the same energy. It was still the same energy. And it really affected the sound, I think, and the project. Being here, you know, being here, being in New York, being in Miami, spending time in these places, like G3 and 1-5 wouldn't exist if I didn't spend the time here, for example.
How do you soak up your environment? Because to me, one of the things that's so fascinating about your process is you disappear.
I do because I need to.
You really do it. And look, a lot of artists say they disappear. They don't really disappear.
There's a difference between
still being around and being within the peripheral vision of the attention syndrome and actually getting the heck out of there. And you just go. Like, first question is, how do you so effectively create privacy for yourself when you're so visible now and people are so curious about what you're doing?
I think it depends on the intention of how you move. It depends, like if you really want to be private, you can be private. That's my point of view. If you want to be low-key, you can be low-key.
Yeah.
I almost feel like I disappear because I needed to.
Why?
Because then I can focus. So I needed to focus to make an album. Like Motomami, I needed to focus and put all my energy and get to the center to create.
And who cuts through that focus? Anyone? Family? Do you take calls from anyone when you're in the studio? And Neil Young said to me that if I'm sitting there and a song comes to me, no matter what I'm doing and who I'm with, I leave that or them and go write that song. And I said, well, how does your family feel about that? And he said, they know me best. They know I have to do that.
There's five people that if they call, I stop the music. I don't care how good the sound is, how good the song it's looking like. I don't care. Like, I take the call.
Because family's really important to you.
Hell yeah.
You made that really clear from the beginning.
Yes, yes, yes. Full. Because I know I'm not going to be doing this forever.
Yeah.
I know that I'm not going to be making albums when I'm 80, probably. I hope I do it till I'm 70 or something, okay?
Rose, there's no difference between 70 and 80. There is no difference. If you make it to 70, you may as well go to 100.
For me, okay, the difference is... the difference is when I stop making albums.
Sure.
Maybe, okay, if it's in when I'm 60, then maybe for me there's a difference between 60 and 70. Okay. So, yeah, I think that my life is going to change at some point, where I'm not doing this and I'm not who I am right now, which I'm cool with it. Yeah. I accept that and I'm happy that it's like that. But I'm conscious too. So family for me first.
So what do they, the people who know you best, what do they worry about you the most?
Oh my God, you should ask them. Like
I'm sure they tell you.
You should ask them. For sure, my mom worries that I don't take breaks.
Hmm.
I did a little bit, 2020.
Hmm. Well, we all did.
Because we all did.
Quarantine, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. But that's it. I think that's it. I literally don't take breaks because I feel like to work at a certain level to get a certain result, you really need to sacrifice like a lot, like time. Relationships, so many things.
This is the thing that I don't think enough people really give you credit for, right? Because your story, if you ask anyone who's a ROSALÍA fan, they'll tell you straight up it's about vision and determination. A lot of emphasis on vision because you're very visual and you present your vision and it's clear it's yours. Not enough focus on the determination that you've shown. Not enough is given, I think, to the part of your story that people don't really know.
Right.
Which is all the work that you put in before
people
started to really realize who you actually were as an artist.
Yeah.
And I guess the question is really simple, but I'd love an answer. A lot of work?
I mean, a lot of work. I think that people sometimes, they've seen my last 3 years or something. I felt them around. I felt they've seen how I was moving, but they didn't see the moves before. And I had the opportunity to do other albums before Los Angeles, but I didn't want to do it because I knew I wasn't ready. I didn't know what I wanted to explain yet, how I wanted to explain it.
Well, in a way, maybe you didn't even when you put out Los Angeles, because that was
Then I felt the urge. Yeah, with Los Angeles, I felt the urge.
You know, I love that album. I just ordered that album on vinyl. It's coming tomorrow, seriously. I'll show you the order. But like, who does that at your age? Who dives into a songbook and makes something that, in collaboration with someone like Raul, and makes that record your first statement, when I'm sure there was this desire for you to come out there?
I didn't have no rush, I promise.
Yeah.
I didn't have no rush. I was like, God's plan is perfect, and this is how it's supposed to be for me. And I was like, I don't know, Rihanna, or I don't know how many artists that I love, they started their career much earlier. But for me, I knew that it was different.
Yeah.
And I accepted it from the beginning.
It
I
was like, helped. Okay. That maturity maybe helped.
I think it helped me to not do an album that I didn't want to do. It really helped me also to make an album when I really felt like I needed to make an album. And for Motomami, it happened the same again. Like, I needed to connect with the urge. I didn't want to make an album just because now is the time to make an album. No, like, I don't work like that.
You talk about God's plan, you talk about an urge. To me, I guess they're the same thing.
Yeah.
The urge is the way God is communicating through you, right? That desire, that like, it's actually, in fact, it's more than desire, it's necessity.
Exactly.
How do you know what that feels like?
I think it's just something you feel. Yeah, I think it's something you feel. I think it's something that you just realize that you start to write again, that you start to think about possible ways to produce a song, possible ways to arrange a song. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
You're welcome. I'm bringing out
you. Look amazing.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you.
I'm okay right now. Thank you, but I'll get there. Trust me.
No, you're going to leave me.
No. I'm going to be like driving while I'm up. Since I'm good.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay.
Maybe. We'll see.
One bite of a churro.
Okay. I'm definitely eating churros. You kidding?
Okay.
I'm the dessert. Listen, my family will tell you when it comes to dessert, like I would skip everything and just get to dessert if I could in a strange way.
We can skip to the third.
No. These look and smell incredible. No, that feeling, I think that I've asked that question to a few artists in my life, and only at very select times do I try to get a better understanding of what it is to listen to your inner voice or God's voice or whatever it is that's inspiring you to do something. Mm-hmm. That feeling that you get, where it starts to happen. Thank you, sir. I really feel like that puts you on a path of absolute uncertainty. Because you don't know, right, when you're going to get there, when it's going to be finished.
Yes, you don't know. It's a leap of faith, for sure.
It's a leap of faith.
For sure.
And we were taking leaps of faith in 2020 on this project, asking you questions. And you took 2021 for the most part.
Yes.
And you blocked us out.
It took me forever to mix, to like get the mixes like exactly what I wanted it to be. It took 9 months or something. I don't know how many.
Just to mix the record.
And to create the visual album.
Yeah.
Like the visuals for the album.
Yeah. Thank you, man.
Thanks, man.
Thank you. Okay, I'm gonna eat. This is
so good stuff. To create the videos for the album, to create the cover of the album and mixing, it took a whole year. So things that I would love that it's like this, it's not like this. And it's just, I feel like I don't feel I'm late if I'm going on my own rhythm, you know?
I do.
You could feel like that at some point. You feel like, oh, everybody's moving. There's so many things happening, blah, blah, blah. But then it's like, whatever. I have my own rhythm.
Yeah.
And I want to do an album in my own terms. I don't want to do it like in whatever way. It needs to be like precise, focused.
Is MOTOMAMI a concept album?
Yeah, for sure.
So what is the concept?
I would love that you tell me because you analyze amazing.
Female empowerment and strength, but through a very individual lens.
Right.
I feel like you're speaking to people, but only on behalf of yourself. So it's like...
What is behalf of yourself?
Personal.
Yes.
Often when people come out and make a record that's conceptual and it's there to inspire en masse, it can be at the sacrifice of your own personal reflection. Mm-hmm. But I feel like this album, you're using your own very personal observations.
Yes. For sure it has personal point of view all the time. I feel like I haven't done that in the other albums. Also, they were much more serious, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And I think that in this one, I was like, I really want to find a way to allow my sense of humor to be present.
Yeah, playfulness.
Album. Yeah, playfulness, exactly. Yeah. Because also that's how I feel. I used to be a lot like that when I was a kid. And I was like, why did I forget that I'm very playful? So it's like, this has to be part of an album, if I'm making an album right now, and that's how I'm feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and for sure, there's concept. It's conceptual because I feel like it's almost like you try to do like a self-portrait of a moment of who you are, how you feel, the way you think, and those are things, specific things. And I think that is that.
You've always been a strong female performer and you surround yourself with strong female presence, you know?
Right.
Dances, the visuals, the whole feeling that you present is that you feel empowered being who you are, not just as a human being, within our species, but as a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to ask you, who were some of the strongest female role models in your life? that put you on that path?
My mom, my sister too. Yeah, for sure, first my mom. But my sister and I, we used to spend a lot of time together. We still do. Since we were kids, we used to do it. And she influenced me a lot. The way she thinks
She's
influenced
older?
Me a lot. Yeah.
So you were her experiment.
Aha. Uh-huh. Exactly. I wouldn't have. It would be hard to find a better description.
Yeah.
I think that's it. Yeah. But I had fun with her a lot, and I think that she has fun with me. And we're lucky that we're friends. Not every brother and sister is friends.
That's true.
You know. And that's true. I feel like probably. We say sometimes that probably if we were not sisters, we wouldn't have been friends, which is crazy, no? Pero life put us in this situation and we became...
Well, you get to practice on your siblings. That's the point. Like if everybody that you were...
You are an older brother?
I have an older brother. And
but you have an...
No, not a younger. I have an older brother.
Okay.
One older brother.
Also, you felt it.
Yeah, I did. But to your point, and he won't mind me saying this, we're very different people.
Yeah.
But we're incredibly good friends. Because of exactly like you're saying, I mean, that sense of family, I think it kind of trains you and teaches you to think outside of your own interests.
Right.
And to explore other things. And that's really the first person you get to do that with.
Because it's right.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Eh?
On this album, there is moments of pure innovation and energy, and it starts that way with Soko. And we know this song because it represents the record up front. And what I love about this song is that
I agree 100%.
It shows a real sense of what we can come to expect. And I wonder how that song actually came to exist. Like, how did you go from this kind of crazy free jazz experience into the rhythm that kind of rides through the album, and then find your way back to it? Like, how do you put that together?
You know that Soko is the last song I made for the album.
It's always the way.
Can you believe?
Always the way.
Right? I think it's...
Because you're free.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's when you really put the pieces together, you understand what you're doing, you understand the palette, you understand the direction, you are clear about what you're doing.
Yeah.
So, and you're freer too, because you have the rest of the pieces, so it gives you confidence, I guess. So I was in New York, I was working in Electric Lady, and it was a night that I remember I was working with Uzi. Uzi got sick, so Uzi left. And I was just me and David, the engineer that I've been working with since I started MOTOMAMI. He's been there like nobody else. And then I just went to the piano. I started improvising a little bit. I found the riff. And then I was like, okay, let's distort this. Let's distort this, let's put some distortion, let's make it sound tougher. And then I tried some different drums that I had because nice guy, this producer from Puerto Rico, he sent me, in the beginning of the process of the album, he sent me a bunch of sounds,
like a pile of drums.
Like library, that is a special one because different generations been sharing this with the new ones. Different producers to each other, which is very beautiful. And I was like, wow, this is very special. Like, I treated it like, oh my God, it's special. And then I was like, let me try to make this work. Because before, I was, to the people I was working with and I had around, I was like, I want to do a song that has reggaeton and jazz.
Right.
Like both. I feel like it can make sense. And they were looking at me, I was like, I was crazy. They were like, nah, this is not gonna work. And literally, I asked them, can you try some stuff like this in this direction? There was few things tried, nothing on the table, nothing. And they were like, even David told me, like later, he was like, you know, like after we did Soko, he was like, you know, in the beginning when you said that idea, I was like, this is not gonna work. No.
Yeah, no. You must get that a lot. I mean, you must have had people throughout your career saying, that's not gonna work, that's not gonna work, because you love to create hybrid energy. You love to take one thing and another thing and put it all together. That's a big part of what drives you.
Exactly, exactly. I feel like music from other places keeps me thinking. It keeps me reflecting. It keeps me inspired. So that's why I always try to like, okay, how can I make this work with this? And then you always get something different. The result, when you try in a way that is maybe not the most predictable, people say that, no? That
usually
you get
in the song.
A different result.
You say it in the song, right? It's like transform, contradict.
Yeah.
Cut it up.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
like take everything and break it and make something new.
Yes. Yes, because sampling exists. Sampling exists since forever, right?
Yeah.
It's just that nowadays it's more obvious.
Yeah, I love the way you wrote that song and the whole montage of thoughts, the way that it's just like a stream of consciousness. And I missed it for the first few listens, and I read the ID piece, which was great. And you talked about the comment that Frank made to you about opening up the world like a nut. Like,
yes.
Do you think he meant pry it open or crack it with a nut hammer?
Okay, so he is the only one who could answer that, right? Mm. But for me, that's what I see.
Smash it with a nut hammer,
yeah.
Crack it open.
Full. That's why I connected with that thought and that image.
You know, I've spent time with him and obviously like the rest of the world who knows his music and loves him, treats him with the greatest of reverence as one of the most magical artists of our time.
Right.
But very few people have been able to spend time in a studio with him. Like yourself, he tucks himself away and he keeps his process private. So without giving too much away, from your perspective, without giving away his process, how was it influential to you working with Frank Ocean?
I think he is very free in the way he creates. And I think that that's exactly how I used to make my albums. And I think that because this environment sometimes is like, you know, like, there's a lot going on at the same time, every day.
Yeah.
And you could forget a little bit of that freedom, that it's usual, that it's natural, but maybe at some point you could forget. And I feel like being surrounded by people that feels free and that is free. For example, my sister, I feel like is a person that like that too. A lot of my friends are like that. And that's always beautiful and inspiring.
Yeah. There's a song on the album, which we fast forward a little bit, Como Unji.
Yeah.
Which is one of the more sort of reflective and very delicate moments on the record.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I can gather, it's really about, you know, understanding that everything has an end. Even something beautiful has an ending to it.
Yes.
You know, finality is not something I think we're programmed to truly acknowledge as people. I think a lot of times we don't want to accept that there's finality in anything.
Wow, that's amazing, and I agree with you.
You know,
it's amazing that you say it because I think that I try to understand that better, and I write songs and lyrics a lot about that, about finality.
Yeah.
Sakura is about that too.
Yeah. Cherry Blossom, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The idea that something beautiful can exist
break
within its framework and ultimately disappear,
yes,
and dissolve.
Yes. So I think that that's hard for us to understand.
Yeah. Well, because we want to hold on to things that we care about as tight as we can for as long as we can. And, you know, when you write a song like Como Unji and you really, really, it's a love letter to finality, really. It's not a sad song.
You think it's not?
It's sad, but it's
also... Why do you think it's not?
Because in many respects, it's a celebration of that finality. It's like, make the most of what you have, right? Mm-hmm. When it's in your hand.
Mm-hmm.
But I wonder how that affects, given that you seem to focus on that as a writer and a creative, it's on your mind even subconsciously, how does that kind of affect your ability or how you actually build lasting relationships? If finality is kind of always there in the back of your mind.
That's a great question. The same I would feel if we talk about like, how do you live if you know you're gonna die, no? Then you just try to squeeze it, you know? You try to squeeze it and then you dream that.
Have you always been like that, even as a kid?
I think so. I think I became more overthinker through time. When I was a kid, I wouldn't think a lot. I would just do.
What's one of your favorite childhood memories? Like, when you think back to your childhood, what immediately springs to mind?
The first one that comes to my head is me running. I grew up in a forest.
Mm.
Me running the forest from the highest point to the lowest.
On your own?
On my own. As fast as I could. Like, as fast as I could. There was roads.
But not because you were scared. Because you're excited and it was a fun thing to do.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Just like that.
Because most times you see on TV people running through a forest, there's someone chasing them.
No. True. so true. Yeah. But I'm not.
That's an important distinction. I mean, it really gives us an insight into your childhood, which is that so nature was a huge part of where you grew up and what you were exposed to.
Yes, full. And I was very nervous. I had a lot of energy. Mm-hmm. I think like I'm a little bit like that. And then I would run. I just would run a lot. I remember myself running very fast when I was a kid. So when you ask me, my first image is that, me running fast.
Yeah. And yet you found the ability to stop and slow down. But again, in a weird way, you know, your energy is going into your creative process. You just make everything else stop that's around you. So last year, while you were mixing the record, well, actually, before you were mixing the record, what was the environment like that you recorded Motomami in? I mean, you were very kind. You sent me this amazing video of you playing a song. Mm-hmm. Which was awesome, just you on the piano, you just say, hey, I think you like this. And it was like, I was so blown away. But it looked like, to be honest with you, the room looked like the kind of room a crazy person sits in. It was just like, it was just white sheets and then some instruments in the middle. So I wonder sort of what the environment is like, you know, when you're not collaborating with people and you're just trying to find that inner voice.
Okay, first of all, when I don't like a space, mm-hmm. I transform it. Mm-hmm. I change things. When I'm staying in a house, I take all the paintings down. Yeah. I move the all the couches and everything. I move everything till I feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. The only way that I could feel comfortable in that place when that you're talking about, mm-hmm. with all the sheets on the wall, mm-hmm. that was the only way that I could change that place.
To block everything else out?
Maybe.
Yeah. But what do you, then how do you tour? Okay.
I prefer staying in houses and feeling the energy of the people that it's been, the personality. I just it's harder to feel comfortable in spaces that doesn't have personality.
So do you like touring for that reason? I mean, can you make peace with the fact that you have to go from one kind of potentially cold place to another?
Yes, because I love discovering new things.
Right.
I love being in different places and discovering, learning. And when I'm traveling, that happens.
You have to...
So compensate.
You have to ensure that happens, right? Because the nature of touring for most artists is that you go from one place to the next because time is money. Mm-hmm. So do you actually say to your team, listen, yeah. I've always wanted to visit here. I need some time.
I'm going to do that for this tour, mm-hmm. for sure. Because in the other one, I was like, okay, what do we have to do? Let's go running.
Through the forest.
I don't want to be late, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
The forest.
Yeah. Still running.
All the time running, right? But not the fun one. Mm. Uh-uh. So at this point, I want to have fun. You know? So I'm like, if I'm in Italy and I want to visit this museum, I'll go. And if I have to do whatever, if I want to ride a bike and I'm in Berlin, I'll do it. And if I want to do this and that, I'll do it. Mm. Because at the end of the day, you spend maybe 2 years touring or things like that. And that's so much time. And I don't want to feel like, I don't know, that I'm not living my life.
There's a song on the record called Diablo, which once again, it's you and James. Mm. It's one of the rare moments that you've opened up the process to another vocalist, The Weeknd, obviously, on La Fama. But you and James have this really amazing tonal chemistry. And he seems to kind of bring a different kind of tone out of you. Like you kind of come to him a little bit, if that makes sense, when you're on the same song. I know how much of a fan of his you are. I love to encourage that kind of conversation because I think that's what breeds just great creativity, is confidence. So what do you love about James and why did you ask him to be on this album?
He's unique. His sound is unique. When I heard his first album, I was like, this is really honest.
Was that a game changer for you, that album?
See, I heard it a lot, yes. Yes, I was hearing it a lot in Barcelona. I remember riding the bike in Barcelona and listening to James' album, or even when I was taking walks. And yeah, I've heard that album a lot years ago. And I feel like I'm always excited for how he thinks and how is he gonna play in this and what's he gonna do. Like, I love the way he sees the keyboard too, how he harmonizes things. Like, he's special. All the people that have been part of this project, I feel like they're all very unique, very special, and I feel really grateful.
It's incredible though that, you know, you pick these very sort of, what I would consider to be singularly focused, creative people who are in their own production. Mm-hmm. And yet you've still been able to, in my opinion, produce this album. Like, mm-hmm. I know there are other producers you work with, but I really do look at you as the producer of your music.
Mm-hmm. as a musician, as a producer, yeah. I feel excited to collaborate with people.
Yeah.
But I think that sometimes people, it's almost like they don't understand because they are not in the studio. They don't experience that, no? But to have collaborators, that doesn't mean that somebody's doing your job. I wish.
Honestly, no, you don't.
No, listen.
No, you don't.
Listen.
No,
I wish.
You don't.
I wish that I could get the result that I want. Mm. Asking other people to do it, because I would live much more. I would spend much more time with my family, with my friends. Honestly.
But then I can't disagree. If it's honest and it's honest and it's honest, but
yes.
Equally, you have this reputation of being a perfectionist and being resilient with your vision and determined. As I said, determination, right, is a part of your story.
Yes.
That's a fair observation, is it not? You are a perfectionist to some degree.
I think so. Yeah, you don't spend like 3 years working on something like maybe, I don't know, like 16 hours a day for months if you're not a perfectionist.
I've spoken to Jose about it. I've spoken to Jose? Yeah, I've spoken to Manny
Jay
American.
Barbin?
Yeah, I've spoken to Manny American about it, you know.
What do you mean? Who you are?
No, but I mean, when we talk about the album, we say, or I'll say to like, you know, Jay Balvin, I'll say, you know, what was it like working with Rose when you did your collaboration? He's like, she's so focused and so dialed into the detail. And I talked to Manny, like, how's the Rosalía album coming on? He's like, you have to ask her because she's completely in charge.
Manny? Oh my God, Manny's amazing.
He was very complimentary about the way that you are dedicated to every detail.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yes, I do. And I feel it's part of how being a musician, how I was built as a musician, I feel like. Because my teacher, my master, my flamenco master, he would be like that. He would be tough on me, like in the best way possible, to be honest. But he would be tough because he would be like, oh no, this run you did, that's not right.
Mm.
This run you did, the timing or the delivery or the intention or the dynamics, or it would be so much detail. And also flamenco has so much detail that it was the best way to learn, I think.
When you're young, you know, I think most artists I speak to at a certain age are just trying stuff out, and discipline is the furthest thing from their mind, right? They're like, don't tell me what to do, and certainly don't put me in a box, and don't tell me to work for it. But you came at this as a student. It's found your way into this show business, but with the discipline of a student. That's really rare.
Because it was the only way for me to approach music. There was nobody around me that could connect me to the industry or anything. Mm. So that was the only way. That's literally the reason why. And then once I was in the, not college, how you call it, the academy.
Academy, yeah.
Yes, in that environment, you kind of become a student and you kind of learn how to become a student, which it humbles you. And I think that's good.
Do you have fond memories of that time?
Oh my God. The most fun I had, it was in jam sessions with other musicians, improvising, blah, blah, blah. Mm. But because the rest, that was not fun.
Mm-hmm.
That was not fun at all. And also, I had no guarantee that it was going to work. And I spent like more than 10 years studying.
Yeah.
And yeah, that was tough.
That's a long time.
Yeah, that was long.
But then to come out there and then to back yourself.
What does that mean? Wait.
Well, I'll explain. When you're a student, you have to back yourself because it's really up to you to achieve the goals you set for yourself, right?
Mm-hmm.
To pass the various stages.
Mm-hmm.
Then you leave and it's like, all right, now I'm going to make my second album and I'm going to kind of have to really back myself, like only believe in myself that this sound is going to work and that people are going to get it.
Right.
We know your story. We know that no one was sitting there. You didn't have a cheerleading squad like, yeah, man, do it. You know,
exactly.
This is it.
Hell no.
Yeah.
That would have been fun, though.
Yeah. But it, you did it your way. And so that self-confidence ultimately, I think, kind of really established what has gone ever since. Were there tough times making that second record, even though you knew you had Malamente in the chamber, you had songs that were going to connect? Were there moments when you were like, this is...
You're asking about El Mal Querer.
Mm.
There was moments of doubt, but much more of reaffirming.
Mm.
And in the same way, I think, in Los Angeles, and in the same way in Motomami. It's like all the time, I feel like I make music trying to challenge myself as a musician, trying to challenge who's gonna listen to it. So that requires faith and patience, and that's something that you never know what's gonna happen, no? You never know what the result is gonna be. But I really almost made a promise with myself of, I know that that's how I started making music. I know that this is my idiosyncrasia as a musician. Idiosyncrasy. Mm. I don't know how to say that in English.
Idiosyncrasy?
Yes, as a musician. Mm. So I have to be faithful of that, loyal to that. I think I'm a loyal person and I'm loyal to the people that I love. And that's just who I am. And I feel like my music is a reflection of that.
I'm going to ask you the hardest question I got right now, but it's also the most kind of playful question, but you're going to hate it.
What?
If you had to pick one of the collaborations that you've done in between your records, where you've been able to go out there and learn something new by working with somebody else, we're talking about Travis, Billy, Ozuna, J Balvin, great list of artists.
Mm-hmm.
We don't need a criteria, and no one needs to feel upset. No one needs to be in their feelings based on the answer.
Are you going to ask me which was my favorite or something like that? Well, what?
Well.
That's not a not fair question.
It could be about the experience.
Okay. No, I feel you. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna be honest. Mm-hmm. My favorite to work with, it was the first person that gave me a chance here in the US. And that's Pharrell.
Ha!
Yeah, that's Pharrell.
That's a great answer.
That's Pharrell. And then after, 2 years after, we worked again. We worked on MOTOMAMI. And
he did the title track, right?
He did MOTOMAMI because
I didn't even know. You just put it in. It's just like no one else could do that with bass.
Come on, that sound. That sound. That's his sound.
Crazy.
That's Pharrell's sound. And I feel so grateful that there's a part of, of Pharrell in this album.
In your life, like you said, first person to really co-sign you.
Yes, and I spend like time with him in the studio, and that's really special. Like how free he is to, again, he's a very free person.
I hear everything's always on, and I hear that you'll just be talking. He'll just go up to a keyboard and start creating.
Is that how it works?
He's always very playful too. He's a very playful person, I think. And the way he makes music, you can see, you can tell. Even with his voice, he plays with his voice.
He uses
his voice as an instrument in so many different ways, and it's so beautiful to see him work. It's inspiring, and I learn a lot. Not just because he's a great writer, he's a great producer. Also, he's fun to be around. Like, I crack up every time I'm around him. Like, I'm laughing so much, and he's always teaching me stuff. He's the best. He's just the best.
He does the best music face too.
See, that's him. That's him. You imitate him. Good. When I tell him the title of the album, he made that face.
Does he do that thing where he looks at you while he's playing music? And he just goes.
No, he don't do that.
He's done that to me once before. It was the most amazing thing. He was just like.
Like, what do you think? No,
yeah,
what do you
think? Yeah, just like right at you. That's awesome.
No, he don't do that. He will be dancing. He'll be dancing in the on the room. It's impossible to not bounce when you are around Pharrell.
That's a question, though. What do you like when it's time to play music to people? Are you like Pharrell? What do you think?
Hell no.
No.
No, because when I'm...
You leave the room?
Not either, because I think that's evasive. Mm-hmm. So not even not confronting too much, not evasive either. Mm-hmm. So that's how I usually try to stay in that... try to find that center, that middle, no?
Yeah.
And with everything. And when I play music for people, usually I'm like, I try to just see it, make sure that it sounds good, that it's not like saturado, and doesn't sound crazy, because sometimes speakers are very traicioneros.
You know your music is crazy though, by the way.
What you mean?
In all the best possible ways. You're like, I don't want it to sound too crazy, but I'm just going to play a song which has
18 different... No, I want that it's crazy. I love that it's crazy. Yes, but I don't want that it sounds bad, okay? Yeah, just that. Yes.
It's a big difference.
Exactly, there's a difference. Yes. And then I want that they have their experience chill without having the pressure of me of do you like it?
It can be awkward.
Also, it can be very awkward. I don't like that. I really don't. I don't like when people play their music to me a lot because I like to listen music.
Listen
to music by myself.
And where is that? Where's the perfect place
to listen?
Oh, I love the car.
Yes, in the car. It's the best way to listen music. So I don't like people when they say like, oh, listening party. No, 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 that's not a party.
It's not a party.
That's not a party. That's not a party.
15 people, and I was like, oh my God, I spend more time looking at the people around me than I do listening to the music or looking at the artist, because I'm worried, like, how are they reacting?
No, the most fun part of that, I think, is to observe people and see how they all have to deal with that situation. Because that situation is not cool. I like to, unless it's your closest friends.
Yeah, yeah.
Then I can understand.
Yeah. You can be straight with them.
Or with my sister, your reaction can be really honest.
And how honest is she?
She's always honest. She always tells me.
Is she brutal? Or does she find a way to...
No, she's brutal.
Brutal. Is there a song on this album that you defied her judgment on? What's her least favorite song on the album?
You ask her. I hope that there's not one that she hates.
I can't hear it. I mean, like I said, start to finish, I think all the effort you put into this record is like, you can hear the love that you put into it. If you raise your kids right, then hard work and detail should go along for the ride, you know? Mm-hmm. But love is a whole other thing. Like being able to stay focused like that, and I hear the love you put into this.
Wow, thank you so much. Because that's true. Mm-hmm. Yes, yes. And I feel like this, I'm very grateful to all the people that have been part of the album, but this album wouldn't exist without the sacrifice and the dedication and the blood, sweat, tears, literally.
So what was the biggest sacrifice?
Being far from home for almost 2 years. Being far from the people I love for almost 2 years. Because I never did that in my life. And I don't know if I could do it again, because honestly, it was really tough.
What did you learn about yourself?
That I'm resilient. I'm resilient.
It's a great lesson.
Yeah, I'm resilient. And I reaffirmed in being resilient during that time. Because it was the pandemic. And there was a lot of isolation, but literal isolation too. And also not literal. Like, I really had to push a lot. That was the hardest album for me to make. That was the hardest one. This is the hardest album that I had to do, for sure. And I had to spend a lot of time like writing by myself at home, being in a room, just writing. A lot of time in the studio, just with David, like pushing, trying to find the right sounds, trying to find the right production, the right arrangement. Like there was, and without that determination, without those days of 16 hours working, this album, and without the decision of making this album 3 years ago, that I decided that this was going to happen, this album wouldn't exist. Hmm. So yeah, I feel grateful for everybody who contributed in it. But as a producer, as a writer...
You gotta be proud of yourself.
Yes, because this made me push myself so much. I've learned so much. I feel like I grew as a producer and as a writer in this album.
Doubt. I mean, when I hear a song like Valeria,
Bulerias.
Song 4 on the album, I'd like to call it.
Song 4. This tour is amazing, by the way.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, churro check.
Wow.
Because we're talking about Barcelona versus Los Angeles right now. We're talking about
it's
cinnamon
different.
Versus...
Mm-hmm. It's different.
It's good though, right?
It's amazing though.
The texture's incredible.
Yes.
They're really good.
Yeah, they're really good.
Getting back to that song, song number 4.
Yes.
You talk about the production, you talk about the ideas. You deserve absolute respect for this. The fact that rhythm never does what mere mortals would expect it to do and drop a third of the way through, or the EQ to alter into a sub at some point.
Yes, Noah did that. Yeah,
and I know it was deliberate because you kept the tension there all the way.
Noah killed it in this one. Mm. Noah killed it. I showed him a reference of flamenco that I love, which was just claps and voice. Mm. And it's one of the purest way to, I think, to do bulerias. The rawest too. And then Noah was excited and Noah started working with
the EQ, yeah.
Yes. Oh. And he killed it. The sensibility he has, it's great, like it's special. And he killed it in that one.
He really did.
Yes.
It's chicken teriyaki?
Yes.
That one is like such a standout club moment.
Mm-hmm.
It's got the street level feel that you just dominate. You know what I mean? But it feels fresh. So I want to know about that song.
So this song happened in the Mercer Hotel in New York.
You recorded it there?
Yes.
That is literally Stealth, the most creative recording studio on the planet. You know, that's where Throne was recorded as well. People seem to just love recording there.
Exactly. Because they don't complain of the music being loud.
Wow.
They really don't. You can like have the speakers like muy fuerte. Mm. And it has vibe. When you go to the street, you see some fashion, then you go back to the hotel, New York. Like, everybody dresses amazing in New York. I'm like, wow.
Yeah, for sure.
In Paris, too. But Paris in New York.
So what's your memory of recording that song at the Mercer? What springs to mind?
Just having fun. Just really laughing while I was writing lyrics. Really laughing. Like, there's irony in the lyrics. And yeah, just remember having fun with it.
So now that this album is done, what have you been doing with your time? I mean, apart from this, and we appreciate this, and I know that there's work to do, but what are you doing with your time if you spent all your time creating before?
Living life, no. I was creating the visuals, and I'm still working on the visual.
I'm glad you mentioned that. It's so important.
Yes, it's so important. It's really important to me because it makes such a difference in the way people perceive the music. And I've been working on that a lot. It took us a lot of effort to prepare that. And
how does that work in your mind? Like the relationship between the audio component, the music, and the visual component. So you're making Swoko. at what point does the treatment present itself to you when you're like, okay, me and my friends on bikes going off?
That was the most explicit way to translate Motomami to visuals, no?
Yes.
And
for sure.
Yeah, the most direct, the most like straightforward. And it had to happen. Like, you know, a video with girls doing tricks like that.
Yeah.
They are amazing.
It's so sick.
Right?
Yeah,
they are crazy amazing. So I was like, people need to see these badass women doing these tricks. Because when my sister and I, we found these girls doing that in the internet, in Instagram, it's crazy.
And that's how that happened. You just found them and then you were like, right.
You're like,
yes,
I want to do a video with this person because I want that everybody, the whole world sees them doing these tricks and they don't have no fear when they do that. And that's inspiring. And then, yeah, there's sometimes that while you're doing the song, it kind of gives you like a direction. In the way it sounds, it gives you a direction visually. But other times, I take a lot of notes of just videos that I would love to do at some point. Mm. And then sometimes you just connect them. You're just like, oh, okay, that with that. And you connect the dots.
Everything we've spoken about in this conversation has come from your creative impulse. And yet you have opportunities to collaborate with other companies and other brands and fashion houses to do things. And I wonder, as someone who is so inherently independent and dedicated to your own vision, what is it really like sometimes when you work with other companies who have their own vision? And let's be really honest here, and I'm not talking about you. A lot of times in fashion, the artist has to play somewhat of a subservient role because you have to wear the clothes in a way that benefits the brand and it's not how you would do it in your video. And I wonder how that balances for you.
Yeah, I think I would do much more things, but I don't because I just collaborate with people that likes to collaborate.
Yeah.
Like real collaboration.
Yeah.
That means
not paid collaboration.
No. Like real collaboration. If we're talking about real collaboration, I'm gonna be really involved. Yes, and I'm gonna like coger el timón. You know, like I'm gonna be like, okay, this is how we're gonna do it. Yeah. We're gonna do this and that in this way. We're gonna use this thing and this other thing. You know what I mean? Like.
Yeah.
I'm very hands-on, so
that explains why you don't do a lot of it.
Yes.
A lot of companies can't handle that.
It's not the most comfortable, I guess. It's not the most comfortable to collaborate with people that is like that. Unless there's a real same vision. Mm-hmm. People that is very hands-on, collaborating with other people that is very hands-on and both have a lot of vision. The only way that it can work is they have the same vision. So unless I share the same vision, or unless I have huge freedom, creative freedom, I do it. If it's not like that, I don't do it. I'd rather do less. I'd rather have less money. I'd rather...
See, you understand the power of no.
Oh, 100%.
And I wonder, because there are some pretty legendary stories in your journey about times that you said no.
What?
No, I mean, there are some big no's.
No, we got to this point.
There are some big no's, you know? And without going into detail, because your reasons are your reasons, and I'm not that conversationalist, I'm not going for that.
That's fine.
But no is an important word to you, right?
Yeah. Exactly. Like, you cannot, like, I don't know, stay true to yourself and be saying yes, 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 yes. I'd rather be able to just say no and lose opportunities and lose things. Yeah, I prefer that.
Who was or who is your mentor, if there is one?
My mentor? Oh my God. I feel like I've had many and I still have some, and that keeps changing all the time. Through time, I feel like it depends on the moment. Sometimes, okay, so I had a flamenco master, Charm La Donna, that taught me a lot of how to like move on stage, was a mentor in that moment.
Or not move on stage, as the case may be, sometimes with these ones.
Like, depending on the artist too, because respect to the people that don't move a lot.
It's incredible.
I've watched you.
I've watched you hold your position for like 30, 40 seconds. It's incredible. It's a true discipline. And that's where you got that from, that idea of deliberate movement.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It has to be intentional, always. In music, it has to be intentional. On stage, it has to be intentional. Everything in a creative project has to be intentional. I feel grateful to all the masters I've had, but even sometimes when I'm in a Uber and that person that is driving starts explaining me something, that person is my master in that moment. Like every time there's a master, always that.
That's beautiful.
If you really pay attention, you find it. And I always want to be a student. I always want to be a student.
All right, so the moment's important. So let's talk about that. Where do you think, and be honest if you can, where do you think you spend the most amount of time? The past, the present, or thinking about the future?
The future, for sure. I try to stay on the present. I always push, try to be on the present. I meditate, I try everything to try to be in the present.
Yeah, me too. It's a practice. It's hard.
Yeah,
it's
that
hard.
Practice is, yes. Ooh, but I try. But my nature is to be in the future. I always project. I always envision, vision. I live a lot in the future.
So you you manifest, you believe in visualization.
I didn't know that this exists when I was a kid, and I would be doing that when I was 9 years old or 10 years old.
I think it's a big concept at that age. I think at that point in your life you are in practice without realizing, and only when the reality around you reflects the dreams you had do you realize the correlation.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
You know.
That makes sense. See. So I live in the future much more.
What does the future look like?
It doesn't look bad.
Yeah. Looks like us fighting over this last bit of churro right now.
It doesn't look bad, you know what? Because however it has to be, I'm gonna be cool with it. I'm gonna be cool.
Wait, how can you say that? Like, can you get to a place in your life at this point where you can say, kind of wherever I end up, I'm gonna be okay with. That's a really strong fait accompli attitude, you know?
Because I don't, no me aferro. I try to not, ¿cómo se dice?
Hold on too tight?
Yes, to the things that I have of who I am. That's why in the album also you find songs that are about transformation.
Yeah.
I try to not hold on too tight. Not either what I have right now in this moment of my life, nor either the love that I get in this moment of my life, not who I am, what I do, blah, blah, blah. Because I know those things change. And it wasn't until the moment that I accepted, like profoundly accepted that and truly accepted that I could keep creating. There's a reason. And it's because, imagine spending all your life, all your time, your effort spent on this vision. I want to be a musician and I want to do it in the biggest way possible. Then you get it.
Yeah.
So how hard it is, the idea of losing that, how frightening it can be, you know, like it's really scary to me, like, but that paralyzed me when I was feeling that being scared, that paralyzed me. And then I was like, no, I don't want to be here. Mm-mm. I need to create. I want to feel free. And then that's when I could continue creating and making songs and make the Motomami album.
When was that moment? You said that moment was when I realized that I could move forward with the freedom.
Yeah.
What was that moment?
That moment was right after finishing tour. It took me months to get there, but I end up feeling like this. See?
Oh, that was awkward.
Come on
oh,
now,
that
come
was
on
awkward.
Now. You lying, you didn't want to eat it. Come on, okay, I'm gonna share it. You went to the churro when I was going to the churro. You were like, oh, come on now.
I was waiting to do that. I'm only here.
You're lying.
I'm only here for the lols, man.
No, I could understand because it's really good.
As much fun as it was sitting around in poppies eating churros and talking process, at some point we had to acknowledge that it's an actual real functioning business that needs customers to make money. And so we went for a walk outside where the conversation went into different territory, both figuratively and literally.
She's the reason they closed down. Nothing to do with me.
What do you love the most about Barcelona? I know it's home, but now you've traveled everywhere. What do you love the most?
The people, because it's the people I love. I mean, there's a lot of people I love around the world, but in Barcelona, there's my family. And that makes such a difference. Also, the food is crazy, too.
Yeah, food's crazy, there. Do you feel like you can disappear
the
there?
The musicians there, too. I can disappear there. Kind of. You can disappear wherever, though.
Yeah.
If you want to, yeah.
I know this is a crazy question to ask because you just made the album of your life so far. But do you imagine, like, what life will be like when you're not doing all this? Like, do you look forward to that?
I'm excited about it, but I don't anticipate. So, but I know how it looks like. I'm gonna be planting things, taking care of animals, mm-hmm. and planting plants, and taking care of that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I'm gonna be.
Raising a family?
Yes, yes, 100%. I see myself having 3-4 kids.
It's the best.
But I realized I feel so much love for music and passion about it. So that's why I keep doing it.
Yeah.
Because even I realized that I could move in a certain way for a reason in the beginning. It still makes sense though now. Even the reason why I move is different. Because now I do it because I cannot imagine one day not making music or not doing this. Oh yes, when I'm older. But then I'm gonna do something
else
with
different.
Love.
Yeah.
We're gonna be another, as I was telling you, I'm gonna be taking care of other things. I'll put love in other things the same way that I put love into music now.
Are you thinking about, you must be thinking about how Motomami is gonna come to life live and how these songs are gonna sound, how these songs are gonna sound live, because when I listen
to- They're gonna sound amazing.
Crazy. Seriously though.
The choreographies are gonna be sick. I'm telling you right now. The sound is gonna be amazing. For life, it's perfect.
Perfect.
I already have so much written about the show. About how is it gonna be, so many draws, 2 or 3 notebooks, full.
Yeah. Do you have like your opening song in the set list? Do you know
the opening song? I think so.
Don't tell us, don't say.
I don't know yet. I cannot promise anything because I won't know till I'm doing it.
Yeah.
But I think it's gonna be Saogo.
Are you gonna do?
I think it's an amazing way to start.
Are you gonna do festivals? Like, are you gonna do Glastonbury?
I mean, who knows? We'll see.
The Glastonbury, who knows? The Glastonbury, who knows? That's the best. Do you know how many? Oh my God! 25 years of living near the UK. You playing Glastonbury? Who knows?
Who knows?
To Pelton Farm this June.
With El Malquerer, we went.
Yeah.
And now, who knows?
Yeah. I always think about like those key shows. Primavera.
Paris was.
That was the one?
Oh my God. Paris and the end, the closing of the tour in Spain.
Yeah.
And Paris El Marketer in Paris, yeah, that was one of my, the ones that, that's the only one I think that I could watch, because I had such a good feeling about it, and then I rewatched it like a year or something after. But that's the only one.
Yeah.
I cannot, usually I cannot listen to my music, I cannot watch the performances, but Paris is the only one that I'm like, okay.
But you don't listen to your music in the car?
Just for the mixes.
The mixes.
Yeah, just the mixes. I prefer much more discovering new music, learning from other music, other musicians. There's so much music in history and nowadays also. How are you gonna spend your time like being all with myself? You know? That doesn't make any sense. How are you gonna lose your time like that, bro? Like, I literally feel like I wish I had more time in the day so I could listen more albums.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna like.
But you can't be doing that when
like
you're
this.
Making your own stuff, surely. Surely you're not listening to anyone else's music when you're making your own music.
No, I do.
Really?
Yeah, listen
albums.
How
can you separate yourself from that being too much of an influence versus being something you can enjoy as a fan?
Because I don't know, I just listen to music as a as an experience. It's something that makes me feel.
You can separate.
It makes me feel good, just like that. I don't know. I just enjoy it.
You're lucky. I mean, you know, the amount of times I've spoken to artists and asked them, you know, do you listen to other people's music? What they're in their creative space, and
that's the best way to do it, by the way, I think, because that keeps you refreshed. That keeps you like, oh, with maybe something triggers, maybe a song triggers you. A different way to produce or approach the song you were doing. Maybe you are, you know, when there's like a block in a song, you are working on that song and you're blocked with the production. Usually, if you're looking for something, you're gonna find it. So if you're looking for a missing piece and then you listen to other songs, maybe
it unblocks it.
You would be like, I could do this and this in here. So why, as a musician, you have to nurture yourself, and the only way to nurture yourself is listening albums. How you're not gonna listen to albums? Like, that's the time that I listen more albums, albums the most.
Facts.
That's the time that I listen albums the most, when I'm doing an album. I don't
She's
know
not how lying.
People...
She's not lying.
This is amazing. Wow.
Cook.